Good morning.
Good morning.
And welcome to worship as we continue our Lenten season. We especially welcome any guests who are here with us. We do have some very special guests, as today we'll be hearing from a representative from the Mission of Hope House, whom we've been working with for many years, but Pandra is here with us today to personally share the ministry that's going on there and give us an opportunity to celebrate personally with them the partnership that we have. So welcome, Pandra and family. Welcome. We look forward to hearing from you a little bit later. So let us now begin our worship by joining in the gathering, which is also the Confession of Sins as it is printed. Let us rise as we are able. In the name of God, who makes a way in the wilderness, walks with us, and guides us in our pilgrimage. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Holy One, we confess that we have wandered far from you. We have not trusted your promises. We have ignored your prophets in our own day. We have squandered our inheritance of grace. We have failed to recognize you in our midst. Have mercy on us. Forgive us and turn us again to you. Teach us to follow in your ways. Assure us again of your love, and help us to love our neighbor. Amen. Beloved in Christ, the word draws near to you, and all who call out to God shall be saved. In Jesus, God comes to you again and again and gathers you under wings of love. In Jesus' name, your sins are forgiven. God journeys with you and teaches you how to live in love. Amen. Let us remain standing for our opening song, Who You Say I Am.
I am who you say I am. I am who you say I am.
the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us now join in our song of praise. Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. God of compassion, you welcome the wayward and you embrace us all with your mercy. By our baptism, clothe us with garments of your grace and feed us at the table of your love. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated.
By celebrating the Passover and eating the produce of the promised land instead of the miraculous manna that had sustained them in the desert, the Israelites symbolically bring their 40 years of wilderness wandering to an end at Gilgal. The first reading is from Joshua chapter 5, verses 9 through 12. The Lord said to Joshua, "Today I have rolled away from you the disgrace of Egypt, and so that place is called Gilgal to this day." While the Israelites were camped in Gilgal, they kept the Passover in the evening on the 14th day of the month in the plains of Jericho. On the day after the Passover, on that very day, they ate the produce of the land, unleavened cakes and parched grain. The manna ceased on the day they ate the produce of the land, and the Israelites no longer had manna. They ate the crops of the land of Canaan that year. The word of the Lord. We will now read Psalm 32 responsively. Happy are they whose transgressions are forgiven,
and whose sin is put away.
Happy are they to whom the Lord imputes no guilt,
and whose spirit there is no guile.
While I held my tongue, my bones withered away,
because of my groaning all day long.
For your hand was heavy upon me day and night. Then I acknowledged my sin to you and did not conceal my guilt.
I said, "I will confess my transgressions to the Lord," and then you forgave me the guilt of my sin.
Therefore, all the faithful will make their prayers to you in time of trouble.
When the great waters overflow, they shall not reach them.
You are my hiding place. You preserve me from trouble. I will instruct you and teach you in the way that you should go.
I will guide you with my eye.
Do not be like horse or mule, which have no understanding.
Who must be fitted with bit and bridle, or else they will not steer you.
Great are the tribulations of the wicked.
But mercy embraces those who trust in the Lord.
Be glad, you righteous, and rejoice in the Lord. One way to describe the gospel is the promise that in Christ everything is transformed into newness. All mistakes will deliberate sins, all old history is reconciled with Christ's resurrection. This is Paul's strong message to the congregation in the city of Corinth. The second reading is from the fifth chapter of 2 Corinthians, verses 16 to 21. From now on, therefore, we regard no one from a human point of view. Even though we once knew Christ from a human point of view, we know him no longer in that way. So if anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. Everything old has passed away. See, everything has become new. All this is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and entrusting the message of reconciliation to us. So we are ambassadors for Christ, since God is making his appeal through us. We entreat you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. For our sake, he made him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. The word of the Lord.
Let us rise as we are able for the Holy Gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 15th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Now all the tax collectors and sinners were coming near to listen to Jesus. And the Pharisees and the scribes were grumbling and saying, "This fellow welcomes sinners and eats with them." So he told them this parable. There was a man who had two sons. The younger of them said to his father, "Father, give me the share of the property that will belong to me." So he divided his property between them. A few days later, the younger son gathered all he had and traveled to a distant country, and there he squandered his property in dissolute living. When he had spent everything, a severe famine took place throughout that country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to one of the citizens of that country, who sent him to his fields to feed the pigs. He would gladly have filled himself with the pods that the pigs were eating, and no one gave him anything. But when he came to himself, he said, "How many of my father's hired hands have bread enough and to spare, but here I am dying of hunger? I will get up and go to my father, and I will say to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Treat me like one of your hired hands.' So he set off and went to his father. But while he was still far off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion. He ran and put his arms around him and kissed him. Then the son said to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son.' But the father said to his slaves, 'Quickly, bring out a robe, the best one, and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. And get the fatted calf and kill it, and let us eat and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found.' And they began to celebrate. Now his elder son was in the field, and when he came and approached the house, he heard music and dancing. He called one of the slaves and asked what was going on. He replied, 'Your brother has come, and your father has killed the fatted calf because he got him back safe and sound.' Then he became angry and refused to go in. His father came out and began to plead with him. But he answered his father, 'Listen, for all these years I have been working like a slave for you, and I have never disobeyed your command. Yet you have never given me even a young goat so that I might celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours came back, who has devoured your property with prostitutes, you killed a fatted calf for him.' Then the father said to him, 'Son, you are always with me, and all that is mine is yours. But we had to celebrate and rejoice because this brother of yours was dead and has come to life. He was lost and has been found.' The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ." You may be seated. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, grace and peace to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, it's good to be back after a weekend off, and I can tell you, we got a text today, you know, that the prodigal son, this text is so rich, and no matter how many times I've preached on it, and I think we all know this parable really well. I mean, along with the Good Samaritan, it's probably the most well-known one. I could preach for hours on this text. You guys open to that? Okay, maybe not. I'll spare you that. But anyway, this is a text which is so radical. If you look at it, if you know the culture of that time, it is just absolutely unbelievable. It's a story that it's called the prodigal son, but I think perhaps the prodigal God might be a more accurate title, because really this story is about God's love. It's about God's prodigal love. The word prodigal means extravagant. It means wasteful. God's love, which is just absolutely unbelievable. I mean, it starts out with the older son just goes to his dad and says, "Can I have my share of the property?" Do you know what that was saying in that culture, what he was saying to his dad? Drop dead. In that culture, he's telling his dad, "I wish you were dead. Drop dead." I don't know about you, but if I would have said that to my father, I wouldn't be standing here alive today. I'm exaggerating. But can you imagine saying that to your parents? "I wish you were dead. Drop dead." But the father just gives him his share. And we know what happens. He goes out and he wastes it all. He squanders it all. And then it says he comes to himself. And he comes back and he's got a nice rehearsed speech. Because I don't know how sincere he is. I mean, he just came back out of desperation. He had lost everything. He had nowhere else to go. He goes back. And the amazing thing is, when his father sees him, his father runs to him. You notice that? He runs to him. In that culture, no dignified person would run to anybody. Any person in a position of authority would not run. I mean, that is humiliating. That is disgraceful. No one would lower themselves to run to somebody else. But the father runs to the son. And the son starts to his rehearsed speech, but the father doesn't want to hear it. The father just simply says, "Hey, quick, let's have a party." And so they throw a big party. This is extremely, extremely radical. So can we understand the older son, his response? Have we ever felt like the older son? That person really messed up, but yet they're getting rewarded for it. I've been such a good person my whole life. I've been obedient. I've done everything. I did everything you wanted me to, Mom and Dad. I've been faithful, but yet... And you notice what he says to his father? "That son of yours," not "my brother." "That son of yours, when he came back, you rewarded him," basically. But the father says, "Son, you always have been mine. All that I have is yours. We had to celebrate." That is extremely radical. Of course, why is Jesus telling this parable? To set the context, the leaders, the Pharisees, the scribes were questioning him. Why was he spending time with sinners? Why was he wasting so much time with sinners? And Jesus' point in this parable, as well as the parable of the lost sheep, remember that one? The shepherd leaves the other 99 to find the one that strayed away. Or the lost coin, the woman had 10 coins and she leaves the others behind just to find that one. The context is, Jesus is telling the religious leaders, every single person on this earth is a creation of God, and every single person matters. And God loves every single person on this planet extravagantly. God's love is what really matters. Because the problem with us is, I think, we want to make love transactional, conditional. "I'll love you if you do this." It's all too often, that's the way it works in the world, right? And that's how some people view God. God will love us if we do this, if we obey him, if we repent, if we do all. And yes, we are to repent. We are to obey God. Of course we are. But yet,
We tend to think that, well, if we do these things, then God will love us. Well, Jesus is just throwing that theology totally out in its head. And sometimes, unfortunately, we hear it in churches, the theology of Jesus died on the cross for you, but you need to accept him. You need to accept him as your Lord and Savior. You need to repent and do this and that. And certainly, receiving Christ as Savior is what we are to do, but we can't do that on our own. God's the one who comes to us first. God is the one with the prodigal, wasteful love who comes to us, even before we can respond to him. God's love is not conditional. It's not transactional. God's love is extravagant, and that's what makes the world go round. I put this image. Imagine the father running after his child. That's what it's like. God's love for us. The father, the mother, or whoever, running after their child, even though running was a sign of humility. The conditional love is not really love. That's just one quote that I use, because it does fit Scripture. God's love is unconditional, undeserved, unmerited. And because of this, because God has loved us unconditionally, we can love each other. It comes out naturally. I shared this actually on Facebook quite a while ago, but yet, how do we respond to God's prodigal love to us? There were some helpful hints here. How do we respond to those who are hurting? You can take pictures of it if you want, if you have your phones, but I thought this was really cool. But yet, sometimes, I mean, how do we share God's extravagant love? In summary, what this chart is saying is it's empathy, listening to people. It's ultimately about caring for people, not coming up with the right answers. We don't always have to have the right answers. Often people just want us to listen. You know, for instance, God doesn't give you more than you can handle, or it's God's will. Instead, how about saying, how can I pray for you? Or, I know just how you feel. How about rather, how are you really feeling? Sometimes, as a pastor, I have done that, especially when I follow up with someone who's lost a spouse or a loved one. Most of the time when you ask people, oh, how are you doing? Well, I'm fine. Sometimes I'll follow up with, how are you really doing? And that opens up often channels. Or one of my parents, you should do this and this. How about, how can I help? I also don't know what to do. How can I help? An honest response. Responding to God's extravagant love doesn't always necessarily mean that we have to do extravagant things. Responding to God's unconditional love often simply means listening and caring for one another, being there for someone unconditionally. Love that does not have strings attached to it, but rather love that is conditional. Now, sometimes you have to use tough love. We just talked about that in Bible study. Sometimes love means setting boundaries or limits to unacceptable behavior. That is true. But in the end, the reason we're able to still love one another is because God has first loved us. Love is not possible without God, because God is love. I think my favorite one is on the bottom. Instead of saying, oh, you'll be fine, how about, I'm here for you. I am here for you. I have found that to be so helpful to me. Someone just saying, I am here for you. When I was first ordained, the bishop told me at my ordination service, you know, Charles, many people probably won't remember what you said at their funeral, but what they will quote you about is that you were there, that you were there. I have found that to be very true. I remember at painful funerals in my life who was there. I don't always remember what people said, but I remember that they were there. Being there is sharing God's extravagant love in perhaps the most powerful way, listening to people rather than trying to have the right answers or telling people what they should do. God's love is extravagant. All we got to do is look at the cross to see what God's love is all about. God giving his only son for us. His son suffering doing far more than simply running to us, but giving his life so that we can be forgiven, that we can receive salvation, new life. That is what love is all about. God's extravagant love, God's prodigal love. We love because God has first loved us. Even in the midst of chaos and destruction and war that we're seeing right now, even coming out of the Ukraine, there's still stories of remarkable love. And I've been reading about the love, for instance, that people in Poland have been showing to refugees, because we know what it's like to be overrun. Examples like that. God's love is still working, even through the worst of the worst. God's prodigal love, extravagant love. And there's plenty of this love to go around. Amen. May the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. Our song of the day is Believe for It. Let us rise as we're able.
let us confess our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. I'd like to continue now with some announcements. First of all, I would like to invite forward Pandra, who is representing the Mission of Hope House. We're grateful to have you with us today to share your ministry with us.
Hello, I'm Pandra Bush. I have worked at Mission of Hope House for about a year and a half. We just would like to thank you a lot. I'll share a little bit of Mission of Hope House with you. The Mission of Hope House is the only 24-hour, 7 days a week, year-round homeless shelter in Waupaca County. While we do provide temporary shelter to those in need, our work goes beyond just offering a bed. When a resident seeks shelter at the Mission of Hope House, they are signing on to a program to remove barriers and obstacles that stand in their way of obtaining stable housing. Most often it is not just a question of finding an apartment, but peeling back the layers of what else is going on in their life and situation. As the barriers ones face are unique to that person's situation, we rely on our community, such as you guys, to partner and help us provide the skills and knowledge to move them beyond poverty. So we have things that we offer, like classes. They have to meet with a case manager once a week. Some of our classes are finances and credit building, anger management, dependability, ethics, nutrition, grocery shopping, parenting, and stress management. That's just a few that we have. The residents really enjoy them. They are part of our program. If they're not at work or attending some other event, it is mandatory that they attend those so that we see they're progressing. Beyond the work we do within the walls of the shelter, we also own and operate the Bridge Thrift Store, which it serves several functions. It helps provide financial support to our programs. It serves the community with affordable household needs, provides no-cost goods to community families in need. Additionally, what it does a lot of times, or oftentimes, when we do have a family or an individual coming in, they're coming in with nothing. I've done a few intakes. When they come in, they have nothing. We get them situated, showered, cleaned up. We give them vouchers to go to the Bridge Thrift Store to buy their clothing. All they need is clothing. Everything else we have to provide for them, like bedding, toiletries, food, everything they need or will need while they're there, is provided for them. Additionally, we have a Meet the Needs program, which means we serve the community at a large as well. If a community member is in need of food, hygiene, supplies, gas cards, referrals to other community services, we also provide those to the community at no charge. Some examples of that are, I would think it is about 2 weeks ago, a family in Clintonville had a house fire. They lost everything. A representative for them or a friend of that family came, and we have many things in our supply closet. A lot of things that you guys have probably donated, such as toothpaste, hygiene, anything like that. I gave them everything they could need. And I let them know if they needed to come back for anything, just come back, and we're always here. We'll help you. We rely on public support to maintain our programs, and we are thankful for this opportunity to partner with you. We are always welcome to tours, and if anybody is interested in learning about more about us, please contact us to set up a time for a tour. We love people who volunteer, our residents. Of course, when they first arrive, they are nervous, shy, timid, most of them, but they really do enjoy seeing people from the outside, because a lot of them aren't necessarily from this community. They're nervous, and it's just helpful for them to be able to broaden their horizons, to feel uplifted by the community, and just know that their support goes beyond the doors of Mission of Hope House. Just wanted to thank you guys for partnering with us. We appreciate it so very much, and we're very thankful for you.
Thank you again, Pandra and family, and I hope you'll stick around a little bit afterwards, because we have what's called Trinity Times. We have some goodies if people want to further continue the conversation. But anyway, thank you for joining us today to see that when we're supporting different ministries, we're supporting real flesh and blood, real people, and it's really helpful to hear what's going on there. Thank you, and blessings on your ministry. I have a few other announcements. I've been asked to remind everyone that the Easter plant sign-up, there should be a sign-up sheet in the back. That it's also been in the newsletter. There also should be a sign-up sheet for the Palm Sunday brunch. After worship, we're going to try a brunch, and we'd like to get an idea of numbers so that we can have the appropriate amount of food. And also there is a sign-up sheet for anyone who's wishing to help us out with Holy Week services. There is needs for just about everything, ushers, altered slides, and so on. A number have signed up already, which we're grateful, but there's more opportunities for those who want to assist with Palm Sunday and are actually all Holy Week services. We're going to be having Maundy Thursday at 6:30. A Good Friday, we'll have 1:30 and 6:30, and then Easter Sunday morning, we'll be having a 6:30 sunrise, as well as a 9 o'clock service. So there's plenty of opportunities to be involved. Anybody else have anything before we continue? Let us now continue with the prayers of intercession. I do have one addition to those who have been on our prayer list. I've been asked to add Vern, that's Don Hess's father, who had a fall and is in ICU currently. And Nina, so let's lift up Vern and Don and family, and we pray for Vern's recovery. Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Gracious Lord, we cannot thank you enough for your prodigal love, your extravagant love, that it's beyond our understanding, beyond our comprehension. Lord, help us to let this love flow through us so that we can share it with others. Lord, at times it is difficult to love. But Lord, help us to stay tuned to you, remembering what you did for us. Help us always to keep that in mind as we relate to others, as we share your love with others. Show us the littlest, simplest ways we can extend your love in our daily lives. And Lord, we lift up to you, first of all, our praises. We thank you, Lord, for Leslie, the great-granddaughter of June. We thank you for her recovery. We pray that you continue to watch over her. And Lord, we pray for healing in mind, body, and spirit, especially for Jody, Jill, Adam, Carol, Larry, Tammy, Trista Joe, Bonnie, Tina, Cindy, Kathy, Helen, Jackie, Dawn, Gerald, Ginger, Anna, Sam, and all others we name. Lord, we also lift up all public servants, especially those serving in the military. We lift up Shane and Zachary and all others. Lord, we pray for all those troubled places in the world, especially for the Ukraine. We pray that you will be with the world leaders so that all of this destruction and suffering will end. We pray for the people there. We thank you for the power of their example, and we pray that you'll continue to strengthen them. And Lord, we pray that you will show us as Christians especially how we can unify to fight suffering and evil. We pray for all those who continue to be impacted by COVID-19, especially medical personnel. Lord, we pray for our schools, administrators, teachers, staff, parents. We pray for all those who are suffering from mental illness, especially from anxiety, depression. We pray that all those who are suffering will receive your peace. Lord, we thank you for our mission partner. We thank you for our Joy and Giving partner, the Mission of Hope House. We pray that you'll continue to bless their ministry as they reach out in love to the suffering, the hurting. We pray that our relationship with them will continue to be strengthened. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. We will now offer up our gifts.
We lift our voices. We lift our
Let us pray. Extravagant God, you have blessed us with the fullness of creation. Now we gather at your feast, where you offer us the food that satisfies. Take and use what we offer here. Come among us and feed us with the body and blood of Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. Let us now rise as we are able for the Holy Communion service. Just a reminder that at Trinity Lutheran, we practice open communion. So all baptized Christians are welcome to commune with us. And we have special bread. Thanks again to Sue for making it. And we have individual cups. The ushers will guide you forward. You'll come up the middle, and then we will serve starting from the left. It's worked out well the first couple of times, so we'll keep it going. So you guys know what you're doing, right, Mark? Okay. All right. So let us now continue with the Holy Communion. We give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. Almighty and merciful God, you are most holy, and great is the majesty of your glory. You so loved the world that you gave your only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but have eternal life. We give you thanks for his coming into the world to fulfill for us your holy will. and to accomplish all things for our salvation. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And again after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." For as often as we eat of this bread and drink from this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Now let us pray together the prayer our Lord Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Come, for the banquet is ready, and all are welcome. You may be seated.
Holiness, holiness is what I long for. Holiness is what I need. Holiness, holiness is what you want from me. Faithfulness, faithfulness is what I long for. Faithfulness is what I need. Faithfulness, faithfulness is what you want from me. So take my heart. Righteousness is what I long for. Righteousness is what I need. Righteousness, righteousness is what you want from me. So take my heart and form it. Take my
Let us rise as we are able. Blessed Jesus, in this rich meal of grace, you have fed us with your body, the bread of life. Now send us forth to bear your life-giving hope to a world in need. Amen. You are children of God, anointed with the oil of gladness and strengthened for the journey. May Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit bless you this day and always. Amen. Let's now conclude with our sending song.
In the eye of the storm, you remain in control. In the middle of the war, you guard my soul. You alone are the anchor when my sails are torn. Your love surrounds me in the eye of the storm. When the solid ground is falling out from underneath my feet, between the black skies and my red eyes, I can barely see. When I realize I've been so alone by my friends and my family, I can feel the rain reminding me. In the eye of the storm, you remain in control. In the middle of the war, you guard my soul. You alone are the anchor when my sails are torn. Your love surrounds me in the eye of the storm. When my hopes and dreams are far from me and I'm running out of faith, I see the future I picture slowly fade away. When the tears of pain and heartache are pouring down my face, I find my peace in Jesus' name. In the eye of the storm, you remain in control. In the middle of the war, you guard my soul. You alone are the anchor when my sails are torn. Your love surrounds me.
In the middle of the war,
sleep.